So this is a list I made in my first week at Bellagio. I've been examining. I am, for those of you who don't know, an extreme action choreographer. This gives away my era a little bit. And I wanted to know, I've been in my book sort of entails the idea I'm on a search for what a real move is. What is the content of action? Not what it refers to, not its ability to demonstrate the capacity music has for separating time intervals, not the exposition of emotionalism, but what can action do that no other discipline can do? And these are some of the fundamental questions I came up with. Perhaps action isn't durational the way it is when it's put with a 40-minute symphony. Maybe it's abrupt. Maybe it is actually not smooth, graceful, etc. Maybe it is really the idea of episodic. And if I was going to ask questions about how perception of action occurs theatrically, because my purview is really theatrical. I put extreme action on the stage with, for those of you who've ever seen a Streb show, about 30 tons of equipment. I ask a question about the where of it, the what of it, the how of it. They are adverbial examinations of what ends up happening when someone gets affected by an action. Not what ends up happening if action is attempting to tell a story. I've been working on this notion, like for instance, what is action's vanishing point? We've figured it out in the visual arts. I think literature has figured out what the arc of action might be and how you tell a story with words and drama. But with action, I feel we have missed the boat because we were on some level unwilling to go to the bottom of it. Here's a little bit of London. My objective was to puncture the skyline of London in a way that people would not believe, be surprised about, happen upon, and also remember for their whole lives. So my first introduction to London was wandering around. It took about 2 years. We were commissioned by the mayor's office and the London Olympic Committee as part of the Cultural Olympiad, not part of the opening and closing ceremonies. We were wondering whether or not we could sort of baptize the air the week before the athletes were going to arrive in London. And given that Streb is not a spectacle company, and obviously getting on City Hall, jumping off Millennium Bridge, attaching bodies to the spokes of the London Eye. I mean, if you can imagine, London gave us permission for all of those things. And I was sort of joking when I went to meet with the engineer of the London Eye, and I go on a little scrap paper, yeah, I'm gonna do ballet, spoke ballet, and everyone's gonna be on the riverside spokes, and they're gonna go down, you know, it's a 400-foot diameter, and they're gonna slide down 200 feet, and then they're gonna when the Northern Hemisphere is going to slide down another 20 feet. And he said, oh, all right. And to do that, we went into the, we also had a commission to go into the Park Avenue Armory, which some of you know is becoming a more or less avant-garde downtown performance space. Would have been a better idea. This was in last December, and I thought I needed to understand issues of human scale and also distance if I was going to deal with the Olympics in London and what my plans were for London. And the issue is when a spectator is 200 feet away from a human body, where does the relevance factor end up seating itself? Can that still matter when you've got a body on the London Eye and it's literally a red speck? And so my notion, or my thought was that the minimalization of humanity could hold enormous content, could move people. And it wouldn't be about what the dancers were doing. It wouldn't be about spectacle. It would be about just the fact of being in this place that no human body had ever been able to access. So we ended up doing a number of things at the Armory, and we had about 800 people a night for 10 nights. And I thought that, for instance, what we did there could be transferred to London on certain circumstances. This is our spinning ladder dance. It's a little bit of a Rube Goldberg idea, but real. So it's a ladder that everyone understands is a quotidian object that, that workers use. And I think a lot of the essence of STREB, Extreme Action, is about the working human that has to use equipment. And this exists as more or less not a metaphor for ladder, but as something that, that bodies can occupy and tame, or not tame. And this is my choreography, so how do I organize these things? This is Human Fountain. That was at the Army. This is Human Fountain in Trafalgar Square. And the other irony was, how do I have conversations with new partners? Partners such as closing the Thames River. So the rivermen, I had explained to them why I needed the river to stop at a certain point. And this was 33 people attempting to mimic the Bellagio fountains in Las Vegas. I started with my 9, and then I added 9 more in New York, and in London they gave us 15. The one was left of 20 was 15 after 5 ran out the door. Quite upset. So this is sort of, how do you get the fallen man in the right spot? They said no to the Tower Bridge. I had such a great idea for the Tower Bridge. And I haven't given that up yet. But the whole project on the Tower Bridge cost $3 million. And that was our whole mission. But here's the crazy thing about the business of invention, and probably true for all of your businesses too. This is us at St. John the Divine with these high-speed winches that move a body 30 feet a second, and apparently can go up to 70 feet a second, but that's mostly for flipping cars and movies. And my riggers would not let us go that fast. But the crazy thing was, we were doing this Monday, the week in January, the Monday after the Friday when we find out the Tower Bridge is off. And we had already spent $42,000 to do this. So I just basically erected a St. John the Divine in front of the National Theater, and we did Speed Angels there. They have plinths on the River Thames. I wanted to hurl people across.
Wow!
By using these air rams, aren't they gorgeous?
Whoa!
They're pneumatic devices, and it is about instant acceleration. That's my DJ. I said, don't do that anymore because. And who could invent falling sideways? I thought they could hurl across from one plinth to another and not fall in the water, and the rivermen said no. And the bishop said no when I suggested I walk up the dome and stand on the cross. Okay. This was Skywalk, and this was dedicated really to Trisha Brown. For those of you who know Trisha, she is my mentor. Even though she did it unbeknownst to her, I followed her, stalked her. I think she's the only living choreographer who invented a new way to move. And she had asked me, you saw just a second ago, to walk down the Whitney and honor of the dance she did in 1971 called Man Walking Down a Building. And here I am with two of my colleagues, Leonardo Torres and John Caston, walking down the City Hall. That might have been the scariest thing I ever did. But I keep looking around at buildings here in New York and... Okay, so finally let me end with this. It was really a cigar box full of bolts and nuts that was falling off my parents' counter shelf. And I planned it all out and caught it an inch from the floor with nothing falling out. But somehow I knew that movement and hardware was going to be my future. I mean, that was 8 and I'm 62 and I'm still waking up wondering about movement. So I'm happy about that. My objective was to puncture the skyline of London in a way that people would not believe, be surprised about, happen upon, and also remember for their whole lives. It would somehow change their sense of wonder or what they thought was possible. First, I had to walk around London for 6 months to a year and choose the sites and get permission for the sites. They had to close the river, close the bridges. So it took a long time to get those permissions, which was a large part of how we were able to do what we're doing right now. One of the predominant things that Streb does that no other physical form does, in my opinion, except for boxing and American football, is not camouflage gravity. So we deal with a lot of impact training. You also have to be able to be a spherical dancer. You have to know where you are when you're not on the bottoms of your feet right side up. The greatest thing about this is that I am different than I was before. To be here before the Olympian athletes arrive, I feel like we're sort of trying to bless the air, the water, the skies, the earth for their arrival, put some action around so that they'd enter into a non-void based universe. Thank you very much.
Elizabeth, that was fantastic. I think what I'd like to do is just get a couple of questions right now and then move on to the other presentations, and then we'll have more questions at the end. But does anyone have anything burning that they want to raise right now? Chris?
Yes. So the question that begs is, what were you doing at Bellagio, designing or choreographing? Because there certainly isn't anything like that.
Just curious how you used your time there.
I was wondering about things, and in my mind's eye, I was drawing. That's how I choreograph. And we had already scoped out London a little bit, so I knew the pieces that I was hoping to occupy the structures. And I needed a lot of alone time to really see rhythmically and physically and conceptually if this was going to be effective, which I wasn't positive about. I thought we'd be just people noodling around in the middle of nowhere, which I feared, but that isn't what happened, so. Bellagio, I'm saying, you know, if I could do 100 Bellagios, I would. It's like the walkabout, you know. I want to do like an extreme action hardware junkie walkabout, you know.
That was sort of my question, I guess, the effectiveness. Very effective for me sitting here, but wondering how you were able to gather whether or not what you aimed to do was indeed effective in London in particular.
How I did that, or?
Yeah, how do you, it obviously was effective, but how do you know that it was?
Well, I could feel the crowds. I guess that's one thing, it's barometric reading. But also, we were not allowed at all to say what, where, or when any of these events was going to happen. I was contractually bound to that, so I figured maybe no one would come. Like, how are they going to get there? So once they started exponentializing and it sort of went viral, it was just like, you know, you're walking by the London Eye and you look up and there's humans on it and you're just like, oh my God. So I felt the dance was in the crowds as much as it was on the structures. The feedback seemed to be positive.
Thank you.
Yes, in the back.
So usually, like, choreography is done in the context of, like a performance or some sort of a musical piece, but that's not what's happening here. Can you say something about how that works for you?
Yeah, I wanted it to be an event that people happened upon, and even though I wanted it to not be something, in a way, it's through the investigation of extreme action, which I feel is one of the most potent languages, I don't feel that you can organize it. I think it happens once, and then it never happens again, and people either are there to experience it or not. And I believe that it has to do with like figuring out what the grammar, syntax, essence of action could be that no other discipline can accomplish. You know, not words, not sounds, nothing. And I'm still in the middle of that query. I think action, you know, when someone slips on a banana peel, I'm sorry. That's just, I don't want them to get hurt, but that is the most poignant thing. That's the most point. And many other acts that aren't so common. Thanks.